Hello, welcome. This is a history of modern philosophy, and I'm Mark Thoresby. In this video, we're offering a survey of key philosophers from Descartes to Nietzsche. If you'd like to follow along, you can use the book Classics of Philosophy by Pajman and Vaughan. Most of the texts we're using are completely free and available online, so there's no excuse, but if you want to follow along easily, you can get that book. So welcome back, everyone. I hope you guys are doing well. Today what we're going to be looking at is an important philosopher, modern rationalist philosopher, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. He lived from 1646 to 1716. You can see he's got some pretty wild hair. Let me talk a little bit about his biography to start, and then we're going to jump into the text today. We're going to do something a little bit different in our analysis of the text. Leibniz was born on July 1st, 1646 in Leipzig. He was actually the son of a scholar and a professor of moral philosophy, though I believe his father died at a fairly young age, when he was 6 years old, and consequently, he was actually largely self-taught. He was a definite genius. He actually invented calculus independent of Isaac Newton. He actually published little in his own lifetime, but the two key works of his, the primary key work was the Theodicy from 1710 and then the Monadology from 1714. A couple of the ideas that he was well known for articulating or advocating include the first idea that this is the best of all possible worlds. In fact, he holds, and we're going to talk about this today, that since God has all power and since God has created the world, it really implies that this is the best of all possible worlds. Now, that seems ludicrous on the one hand, especially when you consider such turbulent events in human history as the French Revolution, or in our own time, our own contemporary period, the Holocaust, or even what's happening today in Syria. How could it be the case that this is the best of all possible worlds? And in fact, Voltaire lambasted and lampooned Leibniz in his famous work Candide. So I encourage you to check out Candide. We will see, though, that the core ideas that he's going to be talking about today are related to the notion of rationalism, the idea that some things can only be known through reason, and his argument of monadology, which we're going to see is ultimately a question about what a substance is. Substance for Leibniz, as it is for other philosophers, particularly Aristotle, ultimately concerns the ultimate nature of reality. And this is ultimately what Leibniz is interested in articulating. We're going to see he argues that reality ultimately is made of substance, but each substance is completely independent of all other substances. And this means, for instance, that the very substance of yourself, your own soul, is totally separate and independent of all other substances, and unaffected actually by other substances. You're probably thinking, wait, what does this mean? We're going to talk about it today. His view here is that each substance is a monad, is completely simple, can't be divided, indivisible, does not have extension, is not a material per se, but is rather something ideal, if you will. We're going to see that he also argues that extension, the extension that things have in space, cannot be an attribute of a substance because all things extended in space can be bifurcated or divided. And something that's ultimately real has to be indivisible, which means that if a monad is indivisible, then it therefore cannot have material extension in space. So this is going to raise some interesting questions for us about the spatiality of our experience, for instance. And the idea of what does it mean to say that each single substance has to be unextended exactly? Leibniz argues additionally that there's an infinite number of substances and that every substance is a monad without parts, simple, indivisible, immaterial. And that there's actually a non-interaction between these monads. But then how are these things actually related? How are two substances interacted? How do two substances interact? Ultimately, they don't interact directly. They only interact according to a pre-established harmony for monads that's been developed by God. So God is going to be the linchpin for Leibniz's entire metaphysical system. We'll also see that he will contrast his system and what was contemporary physics or the scientific revolution. So there's an interesting little discussion there we're going to at least touch upon. One thing you can see is if we're looking at the overarching history, looking from Descartes to Hobbes, to Spinoza, to Leibniz here. What we see is that Leibniz is ultimately trying to reconcile the Cartesian dualism between mind and body with the Hobbesian materialism that we saw by giving this theory of the monad, which is quite different. Leibniz died on November 14, 1716 in Hanover. So that's a little bit, real briefly here, about Leibniz. So what I want to do next is I'm actually going to turn us directly to the text. So I want to do something a little bit differently. Instead of creating and crafting a PowerPoint presentation, or it's not PowerPoint, but a Prezi presentation here on the elements of Leibniz's argument, what I've done instead is I've actually taken notes directly in the text, and I want us to actually use his text directly. Now, this is important because for those of you that are taking the class with me, it's really important that as you read these modern philosophers, as you read any philosophers, that you become an active reader, that you become engaged in the text. I frequently tell my students, and I'm telling you, that the best way to read is with a pencil or a pen in hand. That is, as you read in a text, you should be taking notes, trying to jot down what the key arguments for each section are, and become an active and engaged reader. And this is really an important element to really learning how to study these philosophers on your own. And so what I've done here is I've taken those same notes that I think you should take, and I'm going to use those to take us through the text today. So you can see what I've done here is I've gone through and I've scanned these. Let me put this into full screen here. Let's see here. So you can see here, here's what I've done, and I have all of our all of the reading here that's taken over. Let's see if I can zoom in here. Here we go. And so what I want us to do is, what I want to do is sort of take you through Leibniz's text, Discourse on Method. Now, there's two different texts we're going to be looking at. For the most part, we're just going to look at this text of his called the Discourse on Metaphysics, which I believe was published after his death. But you can see he's a really rigorous thinker, and this is a great introductory text to Leibniz. Obviously, we're not looking at the Theodicy here. But by the end here, we will briefly sort of take a look at some of the discussion that comes out in Leibniz's Monadology, which is, I think, probably a more important text than this one. But this is a great intro text that sort of takes you through the basic notion of his argument. And again, I'm not going to cover everything that's in his text simply because it's not feasible. But what I will try to do is cover the things that are really critical. And I've highlighted those here for you. And I've done this so you can see, get a sense here of what I think an active reader should be doing in their text. And what I've tried to do is use the highlighter to highlight the specific theses or specific arguments that are really key. And then I've sort of written notes on the side. And some of them I'm not going to talk about, but some of them are important. So I hope this will be helpful for you. I think that it is helpful insofar as you can see that this stuff's actually in Leibniz's work. Okay, and especially for a modern philosophy class, I think it's helpful to actually to be an engaged reader with Leibniz. Okay, so let's go through the sections here. You can see here the first section concerns the divine perfection, that God does everything in the most desirable way. Now, what we're going to do here is first, let me make a couple points just regarding the context here for us to consider. First and foremost, remember that Descartes is in many ways the father of modern philosophy, and Descartes' separation between the mind and body, and ultimately Descartes' emphasis on the cogito, or the cogitans, right? Remember, I think, therefore I am, or every time I think, I exist necessarily, right? It was his argument, which means that for Descartes, the first position of knowledge, the first part before we can get to the world, is with the mind. So we're absolutely certain of our own subjective consciousness, our own subjective thought life, as it were. That's something that's immediately available to us and something in an absolutely certain and clear way. And so that's an important point here, is that we're going to see is that Leibniz thinks that that is certain, but what that certainty reveals is it reveals the monadic substance that we are, our soul. So we're going to get to that in a minute. But we'll also see that Leibniz also is very much arguing in his era. And so he really begins here with the notion of divine perfection and the notion that God is totally divine, and that everything that God does is always done in the best possible way. So you can see here that he suggests that the conception of God is the conception that God is an absolutely perfect being. But you could see here immediately he realizes, or Leibniz suggests, that we have to also know what exactly perfection is. And it's important here because Leibniz differentiates between things of which perfection is possible, as opposed to things in which perfection is not possible. Take a look at what he says here. He says one thing which can surely be affirmed about it is that those forms of natures which are not susceptible of it to the highest degree, say the nature of numbers or figures, do not permit of perfection. Okay, wait a second here. You're probably thinking, what does that mean exactly? What does it mean to say that the nature of numbers or figures doesn't allow for perfection? He says, this is because the number which is the greatest of all, that is the sum of all numbers, and likewise the greatest of all figures, imply contradictions. Now think about it for a moment. What's the greatest possible number of all? Well, the greatest possible number of all is going to be the sum of all the other numbers. But you can see there, immediately there's a paradox, which is, well, wait a second, if you have all the numbers and the number line combined into a sum, then you have the greatest number. But can't you then add the greatest number to those other sums? And won't you still get a still greater number? And the answer is yes, because the number line goes on into infinity, which means that if you're going to try to think of the greatest possible number, and you think of that as being the perfection of numbers, it's not possible because it automatically elicits a contradiction. Remember, a contradiction is when you can say that something both is and is not at the same time, in the same way, and in the same respect. So wherever there's contradiction, you have a failure of reasoning. So that means that some things cannot be said to have perfection because they imply contradictions. Now, what he goes on to argue is that ultimately, God's perfection consists in God's power and God's knowledge. God's power, having the greatest amount of power, doesn't imply contradiction, he argues, and neither does having absolute knowledge, as God would have if God exists and God's perfect, right? Having absolute knowledge, there's nothing contradictory about that. And so, in these ways, he thinks that we can talk about the metaphysics of God's perfection. Now, in the second section here, Leibniz goes on to argue that he argues against those who hold that there is in the works of God no goodness, or that the principles of goodness and beauty are arbitrary. One of the things he wants to argue here is really for what you might say is a complete sense of divine providence. That is, all things that exist in the universe have been created by God. If God is a perfect being, then God would only create things in a perfect way, which means that our standards for the principles of goodness and beauty are not simply arbitrary. And if he was living in our own day, he would argue that our views are not simply cultural either, that ultimately they depend upon God and God's formal works, right? And so he wants to argue against these people in particular. And I want to jump down here and sort of read you a quotation here, which I think is in reference to Leibniz's place in the history of philosophy. He says, quote, "In saying, therefore, that things are not good according to any standard of goodness, but simply by the will of God, it seems to me that one destroys without realizing it all the love that God and all his glory, destroys all the love of God and all his glory. For why praise him for what he has done if he would be equally praiseworthy in doing the contrary?" And you can see I wrote here, for example, think of the Euthyphro. Now, we haven't discussed this in this class, but it may be important for you to do so. Take a look at what I have a video posted on the Euthyphro by Plato. But in the Euthyphro, which is a dialogue of Plato's, what's discussed there is what's known as the problem of divine command theory. That is, whether or not things which are good are simply the result of God's command. That is not murdering someone the right thing to do simply because God commands it? Or is it the right thing to do independent of God, and it also happens to be the case that God commands it? And you can see here that one possibility here is that all standards of goodness and beauty are ultimately sourced purely in the will of God, then that would mean that they're arbitrary, right? And it would mean that if God changes his mind, then what's ugly today could be beautiful tomorrow. But that seems very problematic because it seems to be arbitrary, right? And you can see here, he says a little bit later, he says, if arbitrary will take the place of reasonableness, and I'm not going to read further, but you can see there, this is the distinction that Leibniz is drawing here. Either the standards that we have for goodness and beauty are independent by the sake of reason and they're commanded by God, or they're simply arbitrary to God's will. Leibniz seems to suggest the former, namely that it may be true that God commands what's good, but that ultimately what's good is based also in the reasonableness of things. God is perfectly reasonable, and so in this sense, it's not going to be arbitrary. So our standards for wrong and right are not purely arbitrary. Now, this is a sort of important discussion, especially for Leibniz. I don't think it's as important of a discussion for us today, because I don't think we are fighting the same battle that he is when he's writing this. Now, in section 3 here, you can see Leibniz turns to the question, or he argues that he's against those who think that God might have made things better than he has. In other words, he's against the idea that God could have made things better than they are. He thinks this, again, this is the best possible world, right? Take a look at what he says here. He says, I think that, I think that one acts imperfectly if he acts with less perfection than he is capable of, okay? So that's the first sort of standard here. I call it a standard of perfection in terms of the capacity to be perfect, namely that if you act imperfectly, if you act in a way that's less perfect than you're capable of acting. Now, for me as a human being, that means that, you know, if I'm able to jog 6 miles and I only jog 5, then I've done something imperfectly. But with the case of God, God is infinitely perfect, which means God can do all things, which means God has total capacity, total capability. Well, since God has total capability, then that means that if God's perfect, God has to act in such a way that fulfills that capability to its highest degree, right? He gives this example. He says, to show that an architect could have done better is to find fault in his work. So if we look to creation or to the world and we realize that the world could have been better, then that would be a way of finding fault with God. Now, clearly what's at stake here is what's known in theology as the problem of evil. Namely that if God's a perfect being and God has all power and knowledge, then why has God pre-established a world in which sin and evil seem possible? This is a famous problem called the problem of evil. And I don't believe that in the reading text that I have for us to look at here, Leibniz really goes into the problem of evil per se, but it's an important problem he does deal with, right? So let's see here. I sort of like to jump down here to some of the important things. One thing he says here, in our ignorance, therefore, we're tempted to decide audaciously that many things might have been done better. So ultimately what Leibniz is after here is he wants to source our complaint that the world is not perfect in our own ignorance. Namely, it's this, that God did create a perfect world, and that any imperfections that we think we see in the world are purely based in our own ignorance. And that's the type of argument he's going to ultimately make. Now, part of what he's going to get after here, and part of his view here, is that God creates beings which have lesser capacities, right? So obviously, as human beings, if we're created by God, we don't have the same capacity of God. Well, since we don't have the same capacity of God, we can't act in the same way as God. So that means that, and then conversely, or in addition to this, other animals and other beings have capacities that aren't as high as our capacities. And so what you have to realize is that God has created the world, and that everything, all the beings which are in the world, are existing through God, but independently of each other, and that some of them are moving quicker and slower, as it were, in the direction towards perfection, which means that in the grand scheme of things, the world's good, but from our particular vantage, and because of the limitations of our own capacities, and this is fortuitously related to our ignorance, this would imply that there's a sort of that the universe has a grand tapestry that's perfect, but that when we're on our own individual particularized perspective, we fail to really recognize the full glory of things, right? So it's our ignorance ultimately, and it's our own finitude that's the problem of why we think that there's evil in the world and this sort of thing, right? Now, one of the things he does think is that praise comes with reasoned choice. So take this quote here, right? Or let me start here. It says, "For to think that God acts in anything without having any reason for his willing, even if we overlook the fact that such an action seems impossible, is an opinion which conforms little to God's glory. For example, let us suppose that God chooses between A and B, and that he takes A without any reason for preferring B. Now, I say this on the part of God is not at least praiseworthy, for all praise ought to be founded upon reason, which ex hypothesi is not present here. My opinion is that God does nothing for which he does not deserve to be glorified." Ultimately, he thinks that the way the world is, as opposed to A versus B, ultimately has to be based in a reasoned choice by God. So it's not arbitrary either, right? So this leads down to the fourth section, right? And by the way, one of the things I really like about Leibniz is he's very clear in each section. I'm not convinced personally that each one of his arguments fully succeeds, but I do appreciate his consistency and simplicity, if you'd call it that, right? Okay, so four, that the love for God demands on our part complete satisfaction with an acquiescence in that which he has done. Now, Here the discussion is ultimately about the notion that we ultimately should recognize that in the world we have, even though we're ignorant of it, we need to be satisfied by it, right? So take a look at this first passage, right? He says, "The general knowledge of this great truth that God acts always in the most perfect and most desirable manner possible is, in my opinion, the basis of the love which we owe to God in all things." Quote, "For he," I guess it's all quote. "For he who loves seeks his satisfaction in the felicity or the perfection of the object love, in the perfection of his actions," right? So first off, we get a notion here of what it means to love. Love consists in our felicity towards things, that is, our working towards the perfection of things, and in our faithfulness towards things, really, right? So our love for God and our love for the world is sought through a satisfaction, the felicity of the object that's loved, and in the perfection of these actions that are taken by God, right? He says, "I hold therefore," whoops. Hold on, pardon me. Oh, there it is. He says, "I hold therefore that on these principles check comfortably to the love of God is, it is not sufficient to force oneself to be patient. We must really be satisfied with all that comes to us according to his will." Now, this is an interesting passage, and I think it's right. He's saying here that on the one hand, even though we may face a world in which there's trouble, we may think, okay, I love God, but I'll just be patient until things get better. That's not his argument. His argument is that we need to be really, really actually satisfied with the way the world is, not just patient with it. So he has a pretty strict standard here for what he thinks our love of God needs to look like. And of course, you can see here that he's a deeply religious thinker in the sense that all of this is based upon, his entire metaphysical system is based upon a supposition of God's existence, which, by the way, he's going to argue that the ontological argument proves to us. So he agrees with Descartes' ontological argument, actually. Now, five, in what the principles of the divine perfection consist, and this, their simplicity of the means counterbalances the richness of the effects, okay? So he says, it is sufficient, therefore, to have this confidence in God, that he's done everything for the best, and that nothing will be able to injure those who love him, right? And it's this notion of total divine providence, that God is like an excellent geometer, and that God has total divine providence over the government and over the governing of things, right? And that God would, let's see, let's go back. Let's reread that quote again. He says, right, let me go back, whoops. Right, he says, it's sufficient therefore to have confidence in God that he has done everything for the best, and that nothing will be able to injure those who love him, right? So his argument here is that that if you love God, nothing can harm you whatsoever. Now, for some of us, that will immediately smack of really? Because after all, aren't there cases of many good people who love God who ultimately were killed or injured in some way or another? But we're going to see that what we have to realize is that these kind of statements that Leibniz is making, he's making them in the context of a metaphysics. So he's not talking about physical laws here. He's talking about metaphysically, and we're going to see that ultimately the reason that no one can injure you if you love God is because you yourself are a monad that's completely dependent upon God alone, upon nothing else. So accordingly, nothing can hinder you. We're going to see this argument in a little bit, right? He also seems to discuss virtues, right? He says, of all beings, those who are the most perfect and occupy the least space, that is to say, those which interfere with one another the least, are the spirits whose perfections are the virtues, right? So he has this notion here that the virtues ultimately consist in the sorts of perfections that people can undertake on their own, regardless of other people. And you can see here, he's talking about spirits and he's talking about occupying space. Ultimately, he's slowly suggesting to us features of his monadology. So let's take a look at here 6. Let me take a drink of water here. That God does nothing which is not orderly, and that it is not even possible to conceive of events which are not regular. Now, the first thing we're going to see here is that clearly God is the sort of centerpiece of his metaphysical system. But ultimately, it's important to recognize that what God does, as we've already said, and as Leibniz has already suggested, that the actions of God have to be rational because God is ultimately reasonable, right? Because being perfectly reasonable is a form of perfection, and therefore a perfect God is also includes the perfection of reasonability. Now that means that what God does ultimately has to conform to reason. Now, what we can do is we can divide the will of God into two categories, that which is ordinary and that which is extraordinary, right? Now, if for the most part, everything that God does, God only always does according to the correct order. Because if God's a perfect being and God acts perfectly, the perfect being will act in the perfect order of things, right? So that means that God doesn't do anything out of order. Now, this is important because nature appears highly ordered. And we're going to see here that Leibniz suggests that God primarily works in accordance with and through nature. That doesn't mean that it's not possible for there to be things that which are extraordinary, but things which are extraordinary are not per se violations of nature, right? And ultimately, this is the idea, is because if God's perfectly orderly and clearly nature has a certain order and regularity, then that means that the things which God does should conform to that regularity because it comes out of God. But we do know, at least for Leibniz as a Christian, there's clearly many cases in the Bible in which God does things which appear to break the laws of nature. And this creates a bit of a problem for Leibniz, but let's see how he addresses it. Right? He's going to say, therefore, that which passes for extraordinary is so only with regard to a particular order established among the created things, for as regards the universal order, everything conforms to it. So you can see here, one of the ways that Leibniz deals with this problem of the supernatural here, or the extraordinary, is also to recognize that there is, if you will, local regularity versus universal regularity, or what you might say is particular order versus universal order. God will never, under any conditions, break the universal order, but sometimes it can appear, at least to us, that God does something that goes beyond the local regular order of things. So that's a sort of interesting sort of point here. Let me see if I'm right. He goes on to say, thus we may say that in whatever manner God might have created the world, it would have always been regular and in a certain order. God, however, has chosen the most perfect, that is to say, the one which is at the same time the simplest in hypotheses and the richest in phenomena, as might be the case with the geometric line. Right? So in the same way that you can see here is he thinks that God, whatever order God has taken for the world, will conform analogously like geometry or like the mathematician. Namely, that whatever order is the most simple and yet allows for the richest form of phenomena is going to be the sort of order that God uses. He goes on to say that, I do not to pretend at all to explain thus the great mystery upon which the whole universe depends, or upon which depends the whole universe, right? So I think we have here, I put in my notes, a philosophical humility, that even though that for his argument, Leibniz wants to protect the notion that God has divine providence and that that providence is reasonable and regular and ordered, he doesn't also suggest that he knows everything, he knows all the mysteries about God here. So we have to recognize that he's making arguments in conformity to his, what can metaphysically be said, and I think that Leibniz is trying to be careful not to, to convey too much hubris about this metaphysical discussion of God. Now, you can see here what comes up into play is the question of miracles, right? He says, miracle, he actually argues that miracles are quite within the order of natural operations. This is a consequence of the previous discussion, right? He goes on to say down here, he says, when we consider the object of his general intentions, that is God's intentions, however, such as are the modes of activities of created things, and especially of the reasoning creatures which God wishes to cooperate, we must make a distinction. So in order to understand this, Leibniz suggests that we have to make a distinction, right? And let me actually find here. Right, the distinction here is going to be, let me read through it. He says, for if an action is good in itself, we may say that God wishes it and times commands it, even though it doesn't take place. But if something is bad in itself and becomes good only by accident, through the course of events, and especially after chastisement, and satisfaction, have created its malignity and rewarded the ill with interest in such a way that more perfection results in the whole train of circumstances than would have come if that ill had not occurred, right? So on the one hand, you have to recognize that when God acts and does something with good intentions, if something is good in itself, right, then God not only wishes it, but he commands it, right? But what about bad? Why are there bad things in the world, right? You can see here his suggestion here is that bad things occur by accident, partially because of the capacities of all the different creatures, of all the different monads, but that bad things which do occur, occur by accident, but that because of their accidental occurrence, the course of events in the long run, in the full tapestry of things, of history, in the full course of history, those bad things will actually lead to still better and more perfect things. So you have this system here that, yeah, okay, mistakes can happen, but every mistake has its sort of majestic place, if you will, right? Right, he goes on to say that he knows how to produce the greatest good from them, right? Because since God is all perfect, one of his perfections consists in the fact that when bad things happen, God is able to produce the greatest amount of good from them. Now what we see here is Leibniz slowly ticking away at this basic argument of the monadology, which is namely that there's a God that's perfect, God is fully ordered, God is reasonable, and that everything that God desires happens, and it's perfect. The world, therefore, has to be the correlate to God's desire. There is good and bad things in the world, but the bad things occur accidentally, but when they do occur, they actually produce greater good over time, right? So you can see where he's going with here. And you can also begin to get a sense of, in the beginning, when I talked about the basic summary of Leibniz, why Leibniz would suggest that this is the greatest of all possible worlds and how he defends that. And then you can see this is the basic preliminary structure to that defense, though you really need to read the Theodicy in more detail to really get at that notion. Okay. He goes on to say it's quite difficult to distinguish God's actions from those of his creatures, right? This is an important distinction because on the one hand, everything that occurs in the world occurs according to divine providence, but it also seems to be the case that people act out of freedom. So how do we make sense of this, right? He says, in the first place, since activity and passivity pertain properly to individual substances, it will be necessary to explain what a substance is. So this is the first introduction here we have to what his notion of an individual substance is and why he thinks that an individual substance can answer the question or of why or what the difference is between God's actions and human beings' actions, right? Because remember, let's say, for instance, I lie to my wife and I do something that's wrong. Well, by Leibniz's account, that shouldn't have happened. Lying is wrong, right? Lying's not reasonable. But that my lie will actually help fulfill the grander vision of God's perfect divine providence. So how is it that an individual lie that I make fulfills the divine providence that God has, right? The only way to explain this is going to be through his notion of a substance. What exactly is a substance? Let's read on a little bit. He says, "It is indeed true that when several predicates are attributed of a single subject, and this subject is not an attribute of another, we speak of it as an individual substance, but this is not enough, and such an explanation is merely nominal." So think about it this way. By the way, one of the things we haven't talked about is, or I mentioned that Leibniz did in fact invent calculus. So he's obviously mathematical and illogical, but he also did make great strides in helping to produce or helping to propel logic forward. Now, ultimately, Leibniz is not the great contemporary logician that I think he wanted to be, but he ultimately sort of saw the world according, he thought that logic was essential and that whatever metaphysical system we had had to ultimately conform to a logical system too. Now, I want to do something a little bit different here. Let me open up just a quick document here, and I want to show you something. Now, Leibniz was highly trained in classical philosophy, and in particular, Aristotelian philosophy, right? And in Aristotelian philosophy, what you have is what we call categorical logic, in which every claim is known as a proposition, and a proposition can have the form this, right? All E are G, right? Where all events that occur in the world are things that are good according to God, right? So say we have a claim here, all E are G. Now, let me make this bigger so you can actually see it a little bit better. Right, let me make this bigger. So let's say you have this claim. Now, what we can see here is that in this classic proposition, the E here concerns ultimately is what we would call the subject category, whereas the G is the predicate category. Let me actually give you an easier example. Let's say all dogs are mammals. Let me make it a little bit smaller. All dogs are mammals. This is something that everyone knows, right? And the notion here is that dog is the subject and mammals is the predicate. And one of the things that Leibniz wanted to do is he thought that ultimately, when I make this statement, what I'm talking about is talking about dogs. And dogs refer to something that has existence or being, right? So that means that dogs must refer to the substance of something. It refers to a substance. And mammals here is a description, and it is a predicate that is attributed to the subject dogs, okay? And ultimately what he's going to argue here is that whenever we make a statement, the subject term of our statement ultimately has to conform, if it exists, to a being some sort of substance, okay? And of course, one of the things he was interested in articulating is what is the relationship between predicates and their substances. Now, this goes a little bit beyond what we're really able to talk about today, but one of the things I want you to see here is that Leibniz is a first-class philosopher, and he's trying to systematize his own thinking about all these different subjects together, from his religious views about God, from his mathematical views in calculus, to his views in logic and his analysis of Aristotelian categories. All of the stuff Leibniz is trying to synchronize and trying to make sense of. And so that when he says here, it's indeed true that whenever several predicates are attributes of a single subject, and this subject is not an attribute of another, we speak of it as an individual substance. So if you say, Mark Thoresby is a human being, right? Mark Thoresby is not an attribute to some other substance. Rather, Mark Thoresby being alive or being a philosopher, etc., or being a man or being a human, all of those are attributes that apply to me as a single substance. So he's trying to ultimately understand the relationship here between logic and merge his logical views ultimately with his metaphysical here, right? But this is not enough, such an explanation is merely null. That is, we need a better sense of what a substance is. So keep going on. He says, thus, the content of the subject must always include that of the predicate in such a way that if one understands perfectly the concept of the subject, he will know the predicate appertains to it also. That is, okay, so for instance, I'm a human being, and in order to know what substance Mark Thoresby is, you have to know a bunch of different things about me. And if you were to know what I was in my perfect, if you had perfect knowledge of what I was, you would know what all the predicates that appertain to me are, right? In their total completion. Now, I don't even know what those are, right? So we don't know these, but clearly that's something that God does. What he ultimately is going to argue here is that whenever we have an individual substance, and here we should say the maybe dog, let's change it to the dog is a mammal, right? So if I say the dog is a mammal, the substance is dog, and mammal is contained in it, such that if I know what a dog is, I'll already know what a mammal is. And this means that one of the things here is that it means that all predicates, right, if the predicate is to something that has no other, something which cannot be attributed to another thing, then that means that all predicates are ultimately subordinate to and contained within their subject, okay? So this being so, we are able to say that this is the nature of an individual substance or of a complete being, namely to afford a conception so complete that the concept shall be sufficient for an understanding of it and for the deduction of all the predicates of which the substance is or may become subject, right? And so he gives this example of a king and Alexander the Great, and he says that a lot of times when we think about someone being a king, we really just think in terms of abstractions. But if we were truly to know the substance and the being of Alexander the Great, then we would also know, if we had that perfect knowledge, which we don't, but if we did, then we would know what all of those other predicates are that are contained within or applied to Alexander the Great. So the notion here is that you have a subject category, and that within that subject category are all the predicates. Now, this is going to mean that every substance is really separate from all other substances, because the predicates aren't related by reference or by analogy. The predicates are really in the subject, as it were. He says, God, however, seeing that the individual concept, let me make that a little bigger, or hesicity of Alexander sees there at the same time the basis and the reason of all the predicates which can truly be uttered regarding him. For instance, that he will conquer Darius and Porus, even to the point of knowing a priori and not by experience whether he died a natural death or by poison. Right? In other words, what he's saying there, by the way, let's make a quick distinction between a priori and a posteriori. Let's actually write that down in our notes here. This distinction is really important. A priori. Okay, now I can actually spell. This means before experience. And a posteriori means after experience, right? Now, the distinction here is actually really, really critical. And so I'll put them in two different colors here. Right, if I know something a priori, that means I know it before experience, right? So for instance, let's say this. This isn't strictly speaking a good example, but it will work for our purposes. For instance, I know that a foot has 12 inches within it, and I know that before having to look at my ruler, right? Now, strictly speaking, I know that from my experience because I saw a ruler at some point previously. But let's say I say, that is, you need to cut the page at when it's a foot in length, right? And then by knowing that, that means you can cut it either at a foot in length or 12 inches in length, and you can know that before actually pulling out a ruler. Now, in metaphysics, something is known a priori if it's known utterly independent of experience itself, right? Something is known a posteriori if it's known after or through our experience, right? And so we're going to be talking about the a priori and a posteriori as we go through. But let me give you an example. When Descartes argued that God is an innate idea, God has an innate perfection that's in us, that concept is known to us a priori, because we didn't have to have an experience of perfection to know that there is a perfect being, right? At least that was Descartes' argument. Whereas other things, like for instance, knowing that this cup is black, can only be known a posteriori. So what's Leibniz after when he says this, right? He's saying that from God's perspective, every substance contains its predicates within it a priori. That means that if you had perfect knowledge like God, then you would know all of the aspects of your own individual history a priori, right? And so this is the notion here, is that everything that's ever happened to me could be predicated of me or to me is ultimately, for Leibniz, already contained within me from the very beginning. So this is also the notion of divine providence. That is, the moment I was born and created in the world, right, everything about me that would ever happen to me has already contained within me, including, for instance, the time of my death, which hasn't happened yet, knock on wood, right? And so this is the sort of notion he has here. And so what he wants to argue here, because remember, the goal here is to be able to figure out how it's possible for God's will to be fulfilled and how it's possible for us to act in our own on our own merits and yet somehow fulfill that divine purpose, right? And what he wants to say here is, well, first and foremost, everything that happens to you is already within you, right? And so it's going to be this idea that God manipulates the subjects, not the predicates. That's one way to see it, right? Let's go down here to the next section here, right? Pardon me. He says that this section 9 here is on the idea that every individual substance expresses the whole universe in its own manner, and that in its full concept is included all of its experiences together with all the attendant circumstances and the whole sequence of exterior events. Now, this is going to be a little bit hard to understand, but what he ultimately thinks is that each of us has within us our entire history, and our history separate is independent, or all of those predicates are independent of other people's predications, right? So let's take an example. You have me, Mark Thorsby, and you have my wife. Her name is Brandy. Both of us, on Leibniz's view, are substances, but as substances, all of the things that will ever happen to us are already contained within us. It's almost as if, think of it like DNA, that all of the things about us are already genetically in us. They just haven't come to fruition yet, right? But that means that, for instance, when my wife and I got married, you'd want to say, well, didn't we somehow merge our subjects? And the answer is no, right? What he thinks is that I have within me a predication about my wife, but it's independent of my wife, right? And same thing for her. And think of it like this. It also solves this other problem we have regarding the solipsism of the world, right? You as a subject have your own internal experiences of the world. I also have internal experience of the world that's totally distinct from yours, right? So I can never experience the world like you see it, and you can never experience the world the way I see it. Now, what happens when we see each other, right? What happens? That means that we both have each other in our mind, but yet what we're experiencing is still distinct from each other, right? And it's something similar with Leibniz, right? So he thinks that two substances don't interact, right? But what happens is that two substances can have contained within them some notion of the other substances. How is that possible? The answer is because all substances have within them this innate conception of God, and ultimately God's divine providence synchronizes all of our activities together, right? So his view here is that we're really, as it were, in total isolation from each other, but that within each of us, we have a presentation of the world that conforms that is synchronized with your presentation of the world. So I have a presentation of the world, but that presentation is a predicate that's contained within my own subjective substance. And the same thing goes for you. But that when we experience each other, we're experiencing predicates that are within us, but they're synchronized to each other. So that means that there's interaction in an indirect sense, but there's no direct interaction. I don't know if that makes sense. I hope it does, but let me keep going here, and hopefully Leibniz can clarify this as we go, right? He says, these follows from the consideration several noticeable paradoxes, among others, that it is not true that two substances may be exactly alike and differ only numerically. So this is the first point here, is that no two substances can be exactly the same. Because if two substances are exactly the same in terms of all their predications, then that means they're the same substance, right? This actually becomes known as the law for the identity, for the indiscernibility of identity. This is what it's called. And that is that if you take two things, if all of their attributes and predicates are identical, then those two things have to be the same thing. They have to be identical, which means that no two substances can be alike. Every substance has to be totally unique from every other substance. Now, this may seem crazy, but he actually suggests that St. Thomas's discussion on angels is instructive here. Now, most people don't know a lot about angelology, and I swear to you, I promise, there's a real subject called angelology, principally practiced in the Middle Ages, though there's still people who write about it today. And this is the medieval view about what an angel is. Now, Thomas Aquinas talked about this, and one of the difficulties that he articulated is that human beings are all the same species, right? So I'm a human, you're a human, we're all in the same species for St. Thomas, but we're all different individuals in that species, right? But there was a problem when Thomas Aquinas looked at angels, because angels don't have bodies, right? So if angels don't have bodies, then by what means can one differentiate the different individuals of a species? Well, the answer is, without a body, there's no way to individualize the members of a species. And so what Thomas Aquinas claimed is that each angel was its own individual species. That is, no two angels are alike. They're all totally distinct. They're all totally, completely unique. And this is really the notion that he has, that Leibniz has for us, is that each of us as a substance, as a monadic substance, is an entire world unto our own, right? We're completely different. So if you take myself versus my wife, we're totally two unique substances which are not the same. Period, paragraph, right? So he says, furthermore, every substance is like an entire world and like a mirror of God, right? And I wanted to emphasize, because every substance, everything that each individual substance experiences in the world is already contained within that substance. So that means that every substance is really its own world, its own universe. But every substance is related to God, because all of these substances are a product of God. Then that means that each substance mirrors God's perfection and God's divine desire and order and will, right? So thus, the universe is multiplied in some sort as many times as there are substances. So you might say that Leibniz is the first person to articulate the multiverse, because on his view, there's an infinity of universes, at least maybe not infinity, but there's a multiplicity and plurality of universes insofar as each universe correlates to an individual unique substance, right? And he goes on to say that every substance bears in some sort the character of God's infinite wisdom and omnipotence. So I put here, you'd think here about Descartes' trademark argument for God's existence from that second meditation we looked at a couple weeks ago, right? Leibniz agrees there, right? He thinks that within us, essentially within our very nature of ourselves as beings, we have this trademark sense of God's divine wisdom and God's omnipotence. And finally, he says, and since all other substances express this particular substance and accommodate themselves to it, we can say that it exerts its power upon all others in imitation of the omnipotence of the Creator. So what we have here is an essential synchronicity between all these individual substances. So if I was going to draw a picture of it, the way I would draw a picture is, you have these different substances which are totally, you know, closed off from other substances. So I'm sitting here looking at the computer, but I'm not really looking at a computer. I'm not really looking at anything. I'm merely having a subjective experience that is purely a part and parcel of the nature of myself as a divine, as not a divine, but as a substance. And that means that that there is, if there is a thing in the world like a computer, the computer is its own substance, but we're totally separate. The thing here is that we're synchronized in such a way that that it appears that we interact with each other, when in fact we're not really interacting with each other. You can see one of the things that Leibniz is trying to do is he's trying to find a way to bridge the epistemological divide that's created by subjectivism, right? By the notion that what is truly real begins with the cogito, right? But the consequence of that is, how can I get to the world? The answer is you can't get to the world, but the world is coordinated and synchronized. The substances in the world are synchronized by God, is going to be his answer here. So he's ultimately trying to solve the same problem as Descartes, but he does so in, I think, a very unique and interesting way, right? Now, it's interesting here because now he's going to start talking a little bit about physics. I'm not going to spend as much time on this, right? But he does say, I grant that the consideration of these forms is of no service in the details of physics and ought not to be employed in the explanation of particular phenomena. So what we have here is that Leibniz is sort of, he's living at the height of the scientific revolution in the 1600s here, and he's arguing that, listen, my metaphysical observations pertain to metaphysics, not to physics. And that those people who are engaging in scientific physical experimentation, they're what they're doing is separate from what he is doing in metaphysics. So what he doesn't want to do is say that the metaphysics, that his metaphysical hypothesis of substance applies to the physical in terms of the experimental apparatus. Because if he were to do that, it would immediately invalidate either the metaphysics or it would invalidate the physics. He wants to keep physics, experimental physics, as it's articulated in Galileo and Newton and in his own work. But he also wants to hang on to this metaphysical. So we see a division here between the applicability of his metaphysical hypotheses and their relation to physics. He says so again here, right? He does make an important distinction between the free will. He says that we have to conciliating free will with the providential activity of God. So this is one of the important problems, is how we deal with the notion that we seem to be free agents in the world, and yet everything occurs according to God's divine providence. How can both of those two claims be true at the same time? This is a huge problem, the notion of free will and determinism. Today we talk about determinism because we think of determinism in secular causal terms, but for Leibniz, he thinks purely in divine providence. It's notable that this debate between free will and providence is a debate that really begins with Leibniz and other philosophers and theologians. But it's notably not a debate in the ancient world or so much in the medieval world, but it really becomes an important debate in the modern world, where we try to reconcile the subjective with the objective, with the individual to the world. And this sort of tension seems to raise the stakes of this problem. Right, he goes on to say again that, so in the same way that the physicist can explain his experiments now using simpler experiments already made, now employing geometrical and mechanical demonstrations without any need of the general considerations which belong to another sphere. Right, so he's saying keep our metaphysics separate from our physics here. Right, let's see here, and he goes on. There's a sort of brief one here. One of the things he's sort of interesting here is, in terms of my rereading Leibniz for this video, one of the things I noticed is that he's more conservative than I remembered, in the sense that Leibniz, even though I still see him as a rationalist philosopher following in the footsteps of Descartes, he is very much concerned with protecting the conventional wisdom of his day, and he wants to protect some of the arguments of the scholastic period, or what he calls the scholastic philosophers. These are the medieval philosophers like St. Thomas or St. Bonaventure, and he wants to protect these philosophers as actually doing something important, right? He says, the many investigations which I carried on compelled me to recognize that our moderns do not do sufficient justification to St. Thomas and to the other great men of that period, right? So I think it's important to recognize here that even though Leibniz is truly a modern philosopher, he doesn't himself articulate a strong division between modern philosophy and medieval philosophy. He recognizes there's a difference, but he also thinks that Maybe modern philosophers, beginning with Descartes, have thrown the baby out with the bathwater. Maybe there's more we can learn from St. Thomas, and certainly that's Leibniz's view, right? So it's interesting here that he has a sort of conservative protectionism towards the medieval philosophers. I thought found that fascinating. I didn't remember that in my previous reading, so I thought that was quite interesting. Now, the next thing he wants to go on to argue is that, okay, now remember, he starts with this notion of a substance being logical, subject, predicate thing, but he also wants to argue that every substance is unique in its own world in itself, but he also wants to argue that a substance is not extended in space, right? And in fact, that the extension of the body in space is actually something that you might say is imaginary. It's not actually real, right? Now, that doesn't mean that we don't have an experience of space, but the experience, now notice here, that our experience of space is only given through the mental properties of perception, right? So the only way that I know there's space is when I open my eyes or when I feel things, right? And the only so that means it's only through my sense organs that I experience space. But notice that all of my experiences are merely just ideas or concepts in my mind, which means that I don't really know if my body is actually experiencing the world. All I really know is that I have an idea of there being a body in space. And what this means here is that ultimately I sort of begin to see Leibniz here as articulating a form of rationalistic idealism, in which he really wants to say is that the experience we're having of the world is not actually real in the way we think it is. It's real because it's occurring within us, and it's occurring as a part of us, as a part of our substance, a la according to God's divine providential will. But it's not outside of me, as it were, right? He says, we must recognize something which corresponds to the soul. And I'm just going to read the things I've underlined. He says, it is even possible to demonstrate that the ideas of size, figure, and motion are not so distinctive as imagined, and that they stand for something imaginary relative to our perceptions, as do, although to a greater extent, the ideas of color, heat, and the idea of other similar qualities, in regard to which we may doubt whether they are actually to be found in nature or things outside of us. So notice, he's drawing a distinction between the internal and the external. And think of it like color. When you pick something in your room right now and look at it, and you'll see a specific color, right? So use this pen. This pen is blue, or at least it has partially blue on it. I'm looking at the blue. Now, but we know from physical science that this pen is not really blue, right? Because what's happening is the light waves are hitting the blue. They're refracting. A certain portion of those light waves are refracting back into my eye. And in fact, the blue is being absorbed into the substance. And then what's left over is being sent to me. And that's why I see this as blue. So strictly speaking, it's not blue. It's rather my perception of it that's blue. In the same way, he thinks that our perception of space is something that's within us, not in the world itself, right? He says this is why these later qualities are unable to constitute substance, right? So we can't pick out a feature, an attribute of something, and call that substance, because that substance is only given in its full certainty as a perceptual idea, right? So the attributes can't themselves be substances, right? So the souls and the substance forms of other bodies are entirely different from intelligent souls, which alone know their actions. So he seems to suggest that different beings in the world have different substance forms, and ultimately, there's one important type of being or soul is a soul that has intelligence, rationality. Of course, he's talking about you and I. But you can see here, because of the nature of his metaphysics, in a certain way, everything seems to have a soul, at least anything that's a substance, because the word soul is really the same word as substance, I think. And we'll see him articulate that in a little bit clearer terms here a little bit later, right? He says, all the other creatures, he says, oh, here's an important point. At the end of this section, he says, hence it follows, going off of the notion of you have some, what happened there? Right. Oh, I think I'll go backwards. Okay. Going on the notion that you have some things, some substances, some things have souls, some substances do, right? And other substances have intelligence, right? Now think of it. Here, this is it stands in also as a distinction between humans and animals. And he seems to argue that the substances that don't have intelligence exist according to God and by God's divine providence for those beings that do have intelligence. Because it's through intelligence that one species is that humans are able to subordinate another species, other animals. And he says, hence it follows that, quote, all the other creatures should serve them, that is, those substances with intelligence, a point which we shall discuss more amply later. And we don't talk too much more about it in these readings. But what we see here is that, and I wrote it up here in my sort of notes here, is that Leibniz is articulating a form of anthropocentrism. That is the notion that all elements of nature ultimately exist for or around and according to human beings. So the human is at the center of it all. I mean, strictly speaking, God is at the center of all, but the humans are next on the list. And so that's an important sort of thing. So we see an important prejudice here that Leibniz is articulating with regard to the way he views nature and the way he thinks we should view nature as essentially subordinate to ourselves, right? Okay, let's move here now. I guess let me read this. Chapter 13 here is on as the individual concept of each person includes once for all everything which can ever happen to him, in it can be seen a priori the evidences or the reasons for the reality of each event and why one happens sooner than the other. Now, what he's saying there is that as in each person is their own substance and everything that happens to them can be seen and it is included already within them, and the evidences for this reality is also contained within them as well. He goes on, but these events, however certain, are nevertheless contingent, being based on the free choice of God and of his creatures. It's true that their choices always have their reasons, but they incline to the choices under no compulsion of necessity. So here we see an interesting thing. Up to this point, Leibniz has really been articulating and arguing for divine providence. He's been arguing for the notion that God does and God is in control of everything, and everything happens according to God's will. But here we finally see his articulation of the notion that not only is God free, but we are also free as individual substances too. And so that means that we have free choice. So he wants to defend the notion that we have free choice. And that's a really, really important reason, both theologically as well as metaphysically, and also for ethical reasons too. So there's a really important reason to defend the notion of free choice here. But you can see, in a certain way, Leibniz has sort of he's really set up a difficult problem in his own terms, because the question is, how can you rectify the conflict of divine providence with free choice, right? He says, we have said that the concept of the individual substance includes once for all everything which can ever happen to it, and that in considering this concept, one will be able to see everything which can truly be said concerning the individual. But does it not seem that in this way, the difference between contingent and necessary truths will be destroyed? Now, what do we mean there? For instance, a triangle has three sides is a necessary truth. Right? There's only one way a triangle can exist, and that is by having three sides, right? But a contingent truth would be something like, I'm having to mark had a drink of water. Okay? That's a contingent truth because it really did happen, and you're certain it happened because you just saw me take the drink. So this is the difference between necessary truths and contingent truths, right? And we're going to see here that necessary truths cannot be broken, whereas contingent truths don't have to occur, right? And it's this difference which makes all the difference, right? He says that the difference here consists in the idea that the things which are contingent have certainty, right? But that's different from things which are absolutely necessary. And of course, things which are absolutely necessary also, of course, have certainty as well, a different type of certainty. So he says, everyone grants that future contingencies are assured since God foresees them, but we do not say that just because of that they're necessary, right? Think about it like this. Everyone grants that future contingencies are assured since God's foreseen them, right? So remember here, think about, for instance, I'm going to try to give an example, a Christian example that goes along with Leibniz here. Think about, for instance, that, I'm thinking of, for instance, in the Bible, I can't think of a good example off the top of my head, but think of, for instance, in the Bible, if God commands someone to do something and God says, if you don't do this, then this is what will happen, right? If you don't follow my will, then all these bad things will happen to you, right? Well, imagine if a person follows God's will. Well, then those bad things don't happen to you, right? Right. Think about it in the Bible. If you believe in God, then, and you become a Christian, then you get to go to heaven. If you don't, you go to hell, right? So imagine if you're a Christian and you believe in God, then you go to heaven. You don't go to hell, which means that even God differentiates things which happen from things which are merely possible. Right? And things which are merely possible are in alignment with that which is contingent. So just because God can foresee the contingent possibilities does not mean that those contingent possibilities will of necessity come to fruition or actually occur. Right? So whereas by contrast, things which are necessary must actually occur. And so you can see here, what he's doing is Leibniz is sort of sticking a wedge in there and forcing a space in which I think free will is possible to exist along with God's divine providence, right? He says up here at the time, he says, I say that the connection of sequences of two kinds, the one absolutely necessary, whose contrary implies contradiction, occurs in the eternal verities like the truths of geometry. The other is necessary only ex hypothesi, and so to speak by accident, and in itself it is contingent since the contrary is implied. Now that's another way you can see it, is that which is necessary, if you deny that, then you end up with contradiction. If that which is contingent, if you deny it, you don't actually end up with a contradiction at all, right? You only end up with a potential something that's just contrary. Right. And by the way, even though I won't go into it, the notion of that which is contrary and that which is contradictory is also a logical relation that's articulated by Aristotle and in his school. And so there's a lot of logic that's going into play here as he's giving an example. Right. He says, well, let's look at his example. He says, let's give an example. Since Julius Caesar will become the perpetual dictator and master of the Republic, and will overthrow the liberty of Rome, this accident is contained in his concept, right? So that means that all the events, all those things that occurred in terms of him becoming dictator and the master of the Republic, all of those occurred historically, and so they are also included in the substance of Julius Caesar, right? They're already in there. Right? For we have supposed that it's in the nature of such a perfect concept of a subject to involve everything. In fact, so that the predicate may be included in the subject, so I'll skip the Latin. We may say that it is not in the virtue of this concept or idea that he's obliged to perform his action, since it pertains to him only because God knows everything. Right? He says, but it will be insisted in reply that his nature or form responds to this concept, and since God imposes upon us him, his person, this personality, he's compelled henceforth to live up to it. So the notion here is that God gives you a personality and you're compelled to live up to it. But the things that you do as a person and whether or not you do live up to that personality is a matter of contingent free choice. He says, but I prefer to overcome a difficulty rather than to excuse it by instancing other difficulties. And so on and so forth. So he's trying to clarify his own discussion methodologically. Let me keep moving on here. I think I'm getting a little bit behind here. Notice here, nothing is necessitated whose opposite is possible. So the only thing that things which can be necessary are things which revolve around contradiction. He goes on to say at the bottom, necessary truths are founded upon the principle of contradiction. So that means that the contingent truths, the truths that are the things which are possible as a consequence of free choice, clearly cannot violate or contradict these necessary truths. Okay, let's move here to the next chapter section, chapter 14. He says, God produces different substances according to the different views which he has of the world, and by the intervention of God, the appropriate nature of each substance brings it about that what happens to one corresponds to what happens to all others. Without, however, they're acting upon one another directly. So you can see here, I was trying to explain this earlier, and now he's specifically explaining it, which is namely that all the substances are separately, they don't actually interact with each other, but they all seem to occur in correspondence with each other. So that when this one moves, think about it like this, even though these two things don't touch, when this hand moves, when this hand moves backwards, this one moves forward, and vice versa. This is the notion here. So instead of interaction, you have a notion of correspondence between substances, right? He says, now it is first of all very evident that created substances depend upon God, who preserves them and can produce them continually by a kind of emanation, just as we produce our thoughts. So okay, this is another important element. His view of the nature of reality is that reality continues to exist because God continues to enable their existence. That is, all of existence is emanating from God. In the same way that we think, God is thinking the world, or thinking all of these substances. But as we've said earlier, each substance is a world by itself, independent of everything else excepting God. Therefore, all our phenomena, that is to say, all things which are ever able to happen to us, are only consequences of our being, right? So this means that all phenomena are all the phenomena we experience are a consequence of our individual being, because all of them occur within the unique individual substance that we are. Okay, so that means that perceptions and expressions of all substances intercorrespond, so that each one, following independently certain reasons or laws, which he has noticed, meets others which are doing the same, as when several have agreed to meet together in a certain place on a set day, they are able to carry out the plan if they wish, right? So this means that ultimately, all the expressions of a substance are proportional to the possible expressions of other substances and the like. So everything is moving in sort of a pre-established harmony or a synchronicity or a sort of kind of chorus, inter-correspondence. But in such a way that each is effectively unique and isomorphic from the others, or separate from the others, okay? He says, in a way, then, we might properly say, although it seems strange, and I like that because Leibniz recognizes this is kind of crazy, or at least it seems strange, that a particular substance never acts upon another particular substance, nor is acted upon by it, right? In fact, nothing can happen to us except thoughts and perceptions. And all our thoughts and perceptions are but the consequent, contingent, it is true, of our precedent thoughts and perceptions, in such a way that were I able to consider directly all that happens or appears to me at the present time, I should be able to see all that will happen to me or that will ever happen to me. So what's he going after here? His notion here is that, okay, this means that all of the things that, the only things that really ever happen to us are the perceptions and thoughts that we have. Not there's because the body and the space are imaginary. All that we really have are these perceptions and these thoughts. So these perceptions and thoughts happen. Now all the events which occur to me occur in an ordered and in a regular manner. In science, we call this the causal effect, right? One thing causes another effect causes another effect, and so on and so forth. But cause and effect is a bodily notion, right? Here, what we have is a metaphysical notion. So that means that all of the things that occur to me are always already within me, and such that I'm able to recognize what's come before, I should, in principle, be able to recognize what comes in the future, because it's already contained within me a priori, before experience. Now, clearly, he thinks that he knows that we're not fortune tellers and we don't know the future, but he's arguing that structurally, everything that can happen to us has to happen in accordance with our structure that's pre-established. And that ultimately, because of the way in which substances cannot interact, nothing can actually injure me. The only injuries I ever undergo are the injuries that I myself am the consequence of, or in the causal relation to. Okay? Now, this means automatically there's a practical disconnect, right? He says we have to reconcile the language of metaphysics with that of practical life. So it's clear that if Leibniz's view that ultimately everything is separate from everything else, but yet interconnected. The question is, that doesn't seem very practical, because when I pick up my coffee cup or my water cup here and I drink something, it certainly seems like a practical level that I'm engaged and I'm relating directly to a substance. So there's something, there's a division here between this metaphysical language and the argumentation that he has. And again, all of it is based upon the infinite perfection of God. And as a starting point, there seems to be some sort of disconnect, right? He says, thus, a substance which is of an infinite extension insofar as it expresses all becomes limited in proportion to its more or less perfect manner of expression. It is thus, then, that we may conceive of substances as interfering with and limiting one another, right? So he has this notion here is that through the expression of the substance limits itself, right? And that when I limit myself, that is a way in which I can move back, but then you can move into that forward space. So we sort of have a sort of back and forth, if you will, but that back and forth occurs through the metaphysical limiting expression of the substance itself. And by limited expression here, I think what he's talking about are the expressions, the thoughts we have in relation to our perceptions, right? So it looks like that there can be a sort of kind of indirect mediation between two substances, but it's only indirect. He says, for it can happen that a single change which augments the expression of the one may diminish that of the other, right? Think about here of when you have a conversation. When I express something, then that changes the way in the context in which you can express something. And when you express something, that changes the nature and the way in which I can express something. Sometimes expression has this limiting feature to it, which can allow for this interrelationality, as it were. Now, it's still the question of how is all of this possible? And the ultimate answer is because God's divinity enables it, right? That's ultimately going to be the answer, right? He says, the extraordinary intervention of God is not excluded in that which particular essences express, because their expression includes everything. Such intervention, however, goes beyond the power of our natural being or of our distinct expression, because these are finite and follow certain subordinate limits. What we have here is Leibniz will begin by giving a defense regarding the supernaturalness of God, God's supernaturality, if you will, right? He says, how is it possible that God has influence at times upon men and other substances by an extraordinary or miraculous intervention? And some of this, I think, is really related to Leibniz's theology. And I think he wants to defend the notion of God's supernatural intervention in nature. And we mentioned this earlier, but part of it's because of the role that miracles play in Christian literature, for instance, that's so important, right? Nothing in nature, of course, is supernatural, right? So he says that miracles and the extraordinary interventions of God have this peculiarity that they cannot be foreseen by any created mind, however enlightened. And the way I understand Leibniz here is that miracles exist, but miracles don't break the ordered regularity that God has put in place, right? Because they conform to the universal order of things. But the difference here is that what a miracle is a miracle is when a substance or a person cannot foresee something is occurring. That means that miracles are, by definition, instances of that which cannot be anticipated, right? And so this means that this doesn't necessarily mean that it breaks the regularity of the world. It just means that it breaks my ability to foresee it as a part of the regularity of the world. So he's trying to defend the notion here, right? He says, that which goes beyond the natures of all created substances is supernatural. So that means that miraculous events and God's role in the world goes beyond the created substance, and in this sense, it's supernatural. I might even say it's not supernatural. I like the term transnatural. It goes above and beyond that even. Let's keep moving here. What we see here is that then Leibniz goes on to defend goes on to defend some of his work in physics. He actually gives a pretty harsh criticism against Descartes. In particular, he's talking about the notion of the velocity of masses. I'm going to skip this stuff because although it's pertinent to Leibniz, I don't think it's fully pertinent to what we want to discuss here. So let's sort of move forward. You can see, and so he sort of gives a defense and a critique of Descartes. You can see he says, Monsieur Descartes has fallen into error here only because he trusted too much to his thoughts, even when they had not been ripened by reflection. So I love it. He's pretty critical of Descartes, actually, even though clearly he has a sort of sympathetic stance as Descartes, I think, in terms of the role of reason and the role of the ontological argument and so forth, right? He does go on, he does say here, for instance, that motion is one of these things that occurs, and motion occurs in space, and motion can only occur according to a continuum of divisibility, which means it can only occur with extended bodies in space. We've already rejected that, and so that means that motion is not real, but really is something that is merely a feature that's inherent within the substance itself. Now, keep in mind here that a substance is totally simple and indivisible and non-spatial, according to Leibniz. Now, notice that seems to conform to what Descartes called the mind, right? An unextended substance. And it looks like that what Leibniz is doing is he's articulating a preference for mind here. Right, he says, this reflection is able to reconcile the mechanical philosophy of the moderns with the circumspection of the intelligent and well-meaning persons who, with a certain justice, fear we're becoming too far removed from immaterial beings, and thus we're thus prejudicing piety. You can see here, one of the conservative aims of Leibniz is to protect this note, the more classical and scholastic notion of the immaterial, and mainly because of theological reasons here, right? But he's doing it in a way that's completely unique to his own philosophy, right? Now, the utility of final causes in physics. Now, ultimately, what he's going to ultimately argue here is that we have to recognize, let's put it this way. What Leibniz is going to do is he's going to resurrect a classic distinction that comes from Aristotle regarding cause. Aristotle argued that every being, he called it every substance, this is Aristotle, had four causes. That is, you can say that something is caused by something in one of four ways. Either for Aristotle, you have a material cause. So the material cause of a book is paper or wood or something like this. You have the formal cause of something, which consists of the formal structure of something. So you could say a book is the combination of lots of pages of paper glued together. That's the formal cause. You also have the efficient cause. The efficient cause refers to how something is generated or comes into being. So, for instance, the publisher or the author is the efficient cause of a book. But the final cause for Aristotle refers to why something exists. So the final cause of a book is to add more knowledge in the world. That's why we have books, to proliferate knowledge. So we have these four causes. Now, the material, the formal, and the efficient cause are all completely consistent with contemporary physics and with the modern physics that Leibniz is familiar with. But contemporary physics, as well as the physics of Leibniz's day, does away with final cause. That is, we can understand what something's made of, we can understand the structure of how something is made, and we can understand how something comes into being scientifically. But what we can't understand scientifically is we can't understand the why of things, right? Why is it that human beings have a genetic structure? We don't know why. We know how, we know what, and we know in what form, but we don't know why. And that's because contemporary physics, we just don't think that there is a why to these things, right? Now, what we're going to see here is that Leibniz is going to try to say that physics deals with efficient cause, but ultimately metaphysics deals with final causes. And he wants to defend the notion that final causes, we need to be able to talk about final causes. That is, we need to be able to talk about why certain beings exist the way they do. And he thinks that if we do this away, there's consequences, dangerous consequences might occur. He says, I bring no accusation against our new philosophers who pretend to banish final causes from physics, but I am nevertheless obliged to avow that the consequences of such a banishment appear to me dangerous. So you gotta love it. Every philosopher thinks that any new philosophy ultimately wreaks danger and havoc, right? He says the position seemed to go to the length of discarding final causes entirely, as though God proposed no end and no good in his activity. And hold on, this begins to clarify why it is he's concerned here. Because since God is a perfect being, has created the world on his view, everything occurs according to God's will. We know that the God ultimately desires things to be good, right? So only the good is what's desired. And that means that everything has to happen according to a purpose. This seems to mean that the world should be imbued with final causes, right? But why is it that physics today just gets rid of them, right? He thinks there's a problem here. He says, therefore, when we see that some good effect or some perfection which happens or which follows from the work of God, we are able to say assuredly that God has purposed it. For he does nothing by chance, and that is not... And is not like us, who sometimes fail to do well. So God always does what's right, which means everything conforms to a purpose. He goes on, it will be impossible to attribute too much reflection to God's infinite wisdom. So it's important to recognize here is that we can constantly and indefinitely reflect upon the nature of God's wisdom and upon the purposes of God. So you have an infinity of purposes possible because God is an infinite being, right? And we can look here about the admirable structure of animals and things like this, and it looks like they should conform to a final cause. Now, ultimately, what we're going to see here, though, is that, well, let's keep going here, right? It's interesting. I'm not going to go into this too much, but there is a note here, 22, I'm sorry, number 20, chapter 20, where he does talk a little bit about Plato's Phaedo, and he argues against philosophers who are too materialistic. Now remember, the notion of final cause for Leibniz is ultimately related metaphysically to something that's ideal. Right? It's related to the substances, it's related to the ideas and the perceptions the substances have, right? But it's not related to material because he denies the material, right? So which means that it looks like that might be the answer. He says, I find indeed that many of the effects of nature can be accounted for in a twofold way. That is to say, by consideration of efficient causes, and again, independently, by a consideration of final causes. An example of the latter is God's decree to always carry out the plan by the easiest way and most desired way. I have shown this elsewhere in accounting by the catropic and diatropic laws, which I will speak at more length than what follows. We're not actually going to follow up on that discussion, but I want you to see that for Leibniz, the effects of nature can be understood either through an efficient series of causation or through a final set of causation. He's trying to protect both, though I'm ultimately, personally, I'm not convinced that he actually succeeds, right? He says this. What's the best explanation possible? The best explanation possible is one in which we both know how something comes into being and we know why something comes into being. So the best way, plan, quote, the best plan would be to join the two ways of thinking together. Right? He says, to use a practical comparison, we recognize and praise the ability of a workman, not only when we show that what designs he had in making the parts of his machine, but also when we explain the instruments which he employed in making each part. So the most perfect knowledge is one in which we know both, right? He says, though, God is also a workman able enough to produce a machine still 1,000 times more ingenious than is our body by employing only certain quite simple liquids purposely composed in such a way that ordinary laws of nature alone are required to develop them so as to produce such a marvelous effect. You can see here is that Leibniz is clearly committed to the notion that science can find secular reasons to understand the efficient causation of things, right? So he doesn't think that everything has to be a miracle at all, right? He wants to protect science. That's really critical we recognize that. It's easy when we read Leibniz and especially all this emphasis on God to think that he's not a scientist, but ultimately he's concerned with protecting science too, right? The difference, though, is that the, quote, the method of final causes, however, is easier and can frequently be employed to find out important and useful truths, which we should have to seek for a long time if we're confined to that other more physical method of which anatomy is able to furnish many examples. So you can see here, the suggestion seems to be that final causes are ultimately something left to metaphysics, whereas efficient causes are left to physics. And I think what we could say fortuitously is that that means that a philosopher needs to be concerned with both physics and metaphysics. At least that's how I'm going to understand him. Now, moving forward here. And again, there's another critique against Descartes, who doesn't ever talk about final causes, or at least not very often. Okay. Now, what Leibniz says, he wants to return to the immaterial substances and explain how God acts upon the understanding of spirits and whether one always keeps the idea of what we think of what he thinks about, right? Now, one of the things he says here is he says to elevate to nobler lines of thought the thinking of our philosophers who incline to materialistic considerations alone. So, first and foremost, Leibniz is against materialism. And he's against materialistic philosophers like Hobbes, who ultimately thinks that everything should be able to be reduced to just material, right? And by the way, notice we've been talking about Hobbes, but also think about Leibniz's relationship to Spinoza. Spinoza argued that all of reality is ultimately one thing. It's monistic. So all things that exist are just modes of God's existence. Whereas Leibniz takes the complete opposite view, which is, no, there's one infinite God that creates almost an infinity of substances, each of which is their own universe. So you have the sort of extremes here. Spinoza, everything gets reduced to one. And with Leibniz, everything gets expanded to a multiplicity. But what he thinks is that multiplicity cannot be understood purely through material, but rather through the immaterial. And in fact, he thinks it's more nobler. It's a higher way of thinking to think about the immaterial. In fact, Leibniz criticizes the difference between Plato and Descartes. He says, Plato and Aristotle. Plato is more of an immaterialist, whereas Aristotle is more of a materialist philosopher. And that's not quite accurate, but we see Leibniz arguing that Plato's the greater philosopher. And that's because the immaterial lies higher than the material. He says, it must be, they say, that I have an idea of God or of a perfect being, since I think of him, and we cannot think without having ideas. Now, the idea of this being includes all perfections, and since existence is one of these perfections, it follows that he exists. So you can see right there is one of these, the immaterial is greater than material, but it's from there that we can gain an argument for God's existence. As it were, an immaterial argument for God's existence. That is, if God is the greatest perfect being is also would include the perfection of being, of actually existing, which means that the perfect being must include existence. That is, existence is one of the perfections of God. Now, this is essentially Descartes' fifth argument for God's existence in the fifth meditation. This is essentially the ontological argument. And so you can see here is that unlike Spinoza, he thinks that there are arguments for God's existence that do work. Or I'm sorry, unlike Pascal. It's therefore in this sense that we can say that there are true and false ideas according as the thing which is in question is possible or not. So an idea is true if it's possible for that idea to be true and it actually occurs. An idea is false if it's possible for that idea to occur and it doesn't occur, or it's not even possible for that idea to occur. Right, and so what he's doing there is he's trying to defend this version of the ontological argument he gives, namely that therefore the aforesaid argument proves that God is possible if proves that God exists if he is possible. Right, let's keep going here. Now, what I want to do here is let me pull up my page here on my book. And by the way, I don't think we're going to get to the monadology, but let's go through this. What we get here in this next passage is a live, and I'm not going to read through it all because I want to. We're sort of getting behind here, and I want to cast to end in a timely fashion. One of the things we can see here is Leibniz's epistemology. Remember, epistemology is your theory of knowledge, and one of the things that epistemology needs to do is it has to categorize and label and title the different aspects of knowledge. Now, what he's going to talk about here is that there's different types of ideas. There are ideas which are confused. There are ideas which are indistinct. Remember clear and distinct ideas? It's very similar here. You can have a confused idea when you don't know how to differentiate it. Let's read it. It says, "While I'm able to recognize a thing among others without being able to say what it is and what its differences or characteristics consist, the knowledge is confused." So, something is confused if you can't articulate its predicates, if you can't understand what can be attributed to it. That's what a confused idea is. An indistinct idea essentially has the form of knowing, of not knowing your way about. That's when, for instance, you're unable to differentiate things. There's also a distinct idea, which of course is the best. He says, a distinct idea is when I'm able to explain the peculiarities which a thing has, and that knowledge is called distinct. Now, it's important to notice here is the distinct knowledge has different degrees, right? Because if it's distinct, I know its peculiarities. The more peculiarities I know, then the more degrees of knowledge I have about that thing. Now, it's also true, it's also important to recognize that sometimes we can know enough about something, but not fully understand something or fully know something. So, okay, we have confused ideas, indistinct ideas, distinct ideas. We also have adequate ideas or adequate knowledge. That is, that's knowledge which enters into a definition or into a distinct knowledge is known distinctly, even back to the primitive conception, right? So his notion here is that when you have a distinct idea, and you know enough about its definition, it's adequate knowledge, right? We also have a form of knowledge that we can call intuitive knowledge. And intuitive knowledge is when, he says, when the mind understands something at once and distinctly all the primitive ingredients of that conception, and that's what intuitive knowledge is. So there are these different categories for different types of knowledge that are possible. There's also an important distinction here between definitions. And I think this is really, really important. This distinction of Leibniz's plays a large role in my own philosophy, which is the distinction between the nominal and the real, right? Nominal refers to the name, right? So just to understand what a name is, to understand what something is as an idea, is to have a nominal definition. Whereas to have a real definition is to understand something in terms of its instantiation into existence. Or here's how Leibniz distinguishes. He says, it is well also to distinguish nominal from real definition. I call a definition nominal when there is doubt whether an exact conception of it's possible. As for instance, when I say that an endless screw is a line in a three-dimensional space whose parts are congruent or fall one upon another. Now, I'm not going to go through that because I don't think that's too helpful, right? He says, going down here, any reciprocal property can serve as a nominal definition, but when the property brings us to see the possibility of a thing, it makes the definition real, right? So when the property lets us realize that a thing is real, that's what a real definition is. When the property is only reciprocal to the idea, then it's merely nominal. And sorry, I'm going through these quick, so you may need to take some time to understand all this stuff. You may want to read through it a little bit slower, right? There's also another important distinction between that which is causal and that which is essential. He says, if, however, the proof of the possibility is a priori, that is, before experience, the definition is not only real, but also causal. As, for instance, when it contains the possible generation of a thing. Finally, when the definition, without assuming anything which requires a proof a priori of its possibility, carries the analysis clear to the primitive concept, the definition is perfect or essential. So you can have a causal definition of something, that is, a definition which explains the generation of something, that's a causal definition, but you can have an essential or perfect definition when you get all of the elements which are a priori, which lead to the pure primitive conception itself, right? This, but in a certain way, I think in many ways, this chapter, chapter 24, is kind of the most important for us to learn, because it's the most useful for us to consider as we go forward in our next videos on Locke and then Hobbes, who will start to make these distinctions even clearer. Okay? Let's see. I'm going to move forward here because I think I'm going pretty long here. One of the things important is he does, like Descartes, he is in agreement that the best sorts of ideas are clear and distinct ideas. So that's clearly a Cartesian notion directly. Now, one of the things interesting is Leibniz seems to argue in favor of the notion of innate ideas. And if you're familiar with Plato's doctrine of recollection or reminiscence, Plato's view is that all knowledge was actually recollected, not learned for the first time. One moment. Pardon me. Right. Part of the reason, one of the dialogues you can take a look at is Plato's Meno dialogue, M-E-N-O, in which Socrates demonstrates that knowledge is recollected because he's able to take someone who's completely uneducated and simply by asking that person questions, yes or no questions, through dialectic, he's able to have a slave boy articulate some of the principles of geometry, even though they've never been learned geometry. And this leads Plato and Socrates to suggest that knowledge is recollection. That is, he has a view that when we're born, all knowledge is already within us and that we recollect it over time. Now, Aristotle hated this idea, and many other people don't like it. But you can see immediately there's a strong resemblance to Leibniz's own view. Because in Leibniz's view, all things that can happen to us are already contained within our substance, right? Because we're a monad, and that monadic substance is contained within, which means there's something right about this notion. In a certain way, you can say is that, in a certain way, Descartes has one innate idea. For Leibniz, all ideas are innate, right? He says, it's a bad habit we have of thinking as though our minds receive certain messages, as it were, as if they had doors or windows, right? So he does. This is what later on gets referred to as the myth of the given, and we're going to talk about that later when we eventually get to Immanuel Kant's philosophy. But the notion here is that he doesn't think knowledge just comes in, thinking just comes in through our eyes like light goes through a window, right? Rather, he thinks that it's the reverse. The knowledge is already here, and it looks out through the window, if you will, right? He says, nothing can be taught us which we have already not had in our minds the idea. This idea is, as it were, the material out of which the thought will form itself. And this is what Plato has excellently brought about in his doctrine of reminiscence. So you have here a defense of Plato. So you can think of Leibniz as using Plato here ultimately to defend his own view and to argue that his view, his metaphysics, even though it may sound wild, is not as crazy as you think, and that there's other philosophers who have similar ideas. You can see here, he begins to compare Aristotle and Plato, and he says Plato thinks more profoundly. We've already talked about that. He says, these expressions which are in the soul, whether one is conceiving of them or not, may be called ideas. So what an idea is an idea that is a conception that's in your soul. You don't have to think of them at any time, but they're already there, right? That's what it means for them to already be contained within you. A priori. He says, while those which one conceives of or constructs may be called conceptions. So an idea is the pure article. A conception is when the idea is constructed or conceived in the mind at a present moment. Right? So we have another distinction important to epistemology, the distinction between ideas and concepts. And we're going to see that this is not the first time that these philosophers are going to make this distinction. In fact, there's going to be a lot of debate about these distinctions. Okay, let's keep going. In the strictly metaphysical sense, no external cause acts upon us except God alone, and he is the immediate relation which with us only by virtue of our continual dependence with him. So let's go back to the monadology in which all substances are separate, yet somehow they're interconnected. What is the interconnection? It's clear that if something is totally unique, the only way it can relate is through a third term. right? Think of when you try to when you try to add proportions together. 2/3 plus 12/16. The only way you can add those is by creating a third term, a common denominator, right? Well, ultimately, the way in which the monads are coordinated is by a third term that's in each of the monads, and that is God. Because God is continually emanating the existence of the monads, which means that all monads, in some sense, are in a continual relation with God. And since God is in a relation with all other substances, God becomes this third term by which all of these non-related entities can interrelate or intercoordinate, as Leibniz put it. Right? He says, God is for us the only immediate external object, and that we see things through him. For example, when we say when we see the sun or the stars, it is God who gives to us and preserves in us the ideas, and whenever our senses are affected according to his own laws in a certain manner, it is he who, by his continual concurrence, determines our thinking. So God plays the absolute pivotal role, and God is the way in which Leibniz can overcome solipsism. Solipsism is the notion that I'm the only one in the universe, right? Well, if I'm the only one, if I'm a substance that can't interact with other substances, then how do I know that I'm not the only one? The answer is God. God knows. And it's a similar sort of argument. God's not a deceiver either because of God's perfection. And so the things I'm experiencing through God. In many ways, part of Leibniz's argument here is like Descartes' argument, but on steroids. And seems strange, but actually it's quite brilliant, I think. Right? He says, nevertheless, I cannot approve of the position of certain able philosophers who seem to hold that our ideas themselves are in God and not at all in us. So at this point, he's making a difference between himself and Spinoza, right? Spinoza thinks that everything is in God, including the ideas themselves, whereas Leibniz's view is that we have a soul, and that that soul is comprised of particular thoughts, but that soul is independent of God. So there is an independency of the individual in Leibniz that we don't see. So that means that for Leibniz, we are not merely modes, but we are actually individual substances, right? So it's a metaphysics. There's a metaphysics to us. It's not just a theology, right? God sticks to the established, right? God sticks to these cooperating and ordinary actions that follow regular laws, right? And that regularity of laws is ultimately that which forms the basis for the synchronicity of our intercoordination, right? He says God determines it by that which appears most desirable, and it therefore devolves upon the soul to be on guard against appearances. By means of the firm will to reflect and to refuse to act or decide in certain circumstances, except after mature deliberation. Right? The notion here is that God structures our will towards that which is most desirable. Right? So every substance that has a soul, like us, has desire, and we naturally desire that which is that which should be the most desirable. And that's because of this God relationship. But he says, but you object, perhaps, it is ordained from all eternity that I will sin. Find your own answer. Perhaps it hasn't been. Now then, without asking for what we are able to know in regard to what to which you can have no light, act according to your duty and according to your knowledge. In a certain way, there's a sense here is that when we ask the question of, okay, did God foreordain me to do what's wrong? And his answer seems to be no. But I don't think he has a really good reason here. He seems to suggest that, yeah, maybe God, maybe you don't have a free will, but you seem to act like you have a free will. And when I ask you if you can choose things, you seem to tell me you can. So act according to your duty as best you can. It looks like there's a certain sort of resignation, though. Because he says at the top here, to this question, however, we can expect no answer here on earth, excepting to say in general that it is because God has found it good that he should exist notwithstanding that sin which he foresaw. So it seems to be saying, I don't know, Leibniz seems to be resigned to the theological here, and we don't really know what the reason is, and that we won't know until we're dead, right? But what is evil? Leibniz relies on Saint Augustine here, and you can see his conservative nature going back to the medievals. And Saint Augustine's view is that evil is not something real, and that is, evil is privation, or it's a lack or a limitation of creatures, right? Because one of the concerns that Augustine and obviously Leibniz has is, if God created the world and God's good, then why is there evil in the world? Well, what is evil? If evil is really nothing, that is, evil is the lack of something, evil is a diminishment of being, then that means that evil doesn't have to have a cause. It's the diminishment that has to have a cause. But evil as such is just negativity. So he says, St. Augustine and of the other authors, that the root of evil is in the negativity. That is to say, in the lack or limitation of creatures, which God graciously remedies by whatever degree of perfection it pleases him to give. And then he talks about the grace of God. But you can see here that Leibniz, his view, he seems to be relying upon a notion here of saying, well, okay, when we sin, it's not that we're actually doing something, it's actually a limitation of ourselves, right? So when I do wrong, I'm not doing that which is most desirable by God and therefore by myself, which means it's my own failing. My own failing is a lack, it's a negativity. That negativity doesn't have to have a cause, and God doesn't have to be the cause, right? So in a certain way, evil occurs as a side effect of the limitation of beings, but it's not something real in the full sense of the term. Evil is not a substance. Only substances exist, right? So that means that the grace of God, he says, is wholly unprejudiced, and creatures have no claim upon it. Which means that God, think about this, God is totally objective, right? It says the same question, however, again raises as to why God gives to some rather than to others the grace of faith or of good works. And here, these are really theological problems, which is namely, why is it that if God created all of the world, why is it that God would have created a world in which some people go to hell, some people are evil, and so on and so forth? And you can think here about, for instance, Judas in the Bible. Without Judas, there would be no crucifixion of Christ. If there's no crucifixion of Christ for Christians, then there can be no salvation. So that means that Judas has to commit evil in order for us to have the good work of salvation. Huh? That doesn't seem fair. Why would that be the case? And Leibniz needs to try to, he's trying to shore up some of these problems by thinking about the necessity of possible beings. And I'm going to sort of skip through that because I don't think it's totally pertinent. It's more of a theological aside. And you can see he then begins to talk about, he continues to talk about God. He says, really, God is the key relation, where he says, God alone constitutes the relation or the communication between substances. And this means that every substance has a perfect spontaneity, right? Something is spontaneous if it's uncaused by another thing. It looks like if I'm a substance that's not caused by any other things, has no immediate relationship or direct relationship to any other things, then that means that everything that's occurring to me is occurring spontaneously. So every substance has a perfect spontaneity because its perfect spontaneity is in communication or in interconnectivity with all other spontaneity, right? Well, I think one of the questions here is, this seems like a fairly complicated way to explain something that maybe could be just explained simply by saying that there really is interactivity among things. So you have to ask yourself, to what degree is Leibniz's metaphysics motivated out of a concern to maintain its own self-referential consistency versus to actually give us the simplest, clear explanation? Anyway, that's a little criticism I have against it, right? He says, furthermore, the changes in this extended mass, which is called out of the body, cannot possibly affect the soul. So his view here is that the body and the soul are totally separate. My body is the perception I have of myself being a substance in relation with others. It's not really extended in space. That's not what I really am. It's my soul that's real. And the soul and the body are not related. The soul is totally real, whereas the body is not. So what affects the body cannot affect the soul. By the way, this sounds a lot like Plato's third book of the Republic, where he argues the exact same thing. Right? But then, of course, how can we explain the union between the soul and the body, right? Because it looks like that everything which happens to a soul or to a substance is a consequence of its concept. Hence, the idea itself or the essence of the soul brings it about that all of its appearances or perceptions should be born out of its nature precisely in such a way that they correspond of themselves to that which happens in the universe at large, but more particularly, more perfectly, to that which happens to the body associated with it, because it is in a particular way and only for a certain time, according to the relation of other bodies to its own bodies, that the soul expresses the state of the universe. So it seems to be here a sort of fascinating set of reasons here that there's a parallelism between the soul and the body, and that that parallelism is important because that parallelism is what gives me the clue, at least this is how I understand it, in terms of how I'm in relationship to other beings. And so the two have to be unified, though one is substantial, whereas the other is not. Okay. Let's see here. 34, concerning the difference between spirits and other substances, souls, or substantial forms, right? He says the principal difference, however, is that they do not know that they are, nor what they are, right? He's saying here, well, actually, let me go back here. Let me read this. Concerning the difference between spirits and other substances, souls, or substantial forms, that the immateriality which men desire includes memory, right? So you've got a lot going on here. But what he seems to be suggesting is that, for instance, animals lack the essential and existential knowledge. That is, an animal has a soul, or maybe any other substance which doesn't have rationality, is unable to know that it is, and it's unable to know what it is. There's two criteria there. There's an essential criteria, knowing what you are, and there's an existential criteria, knowing that you are. Substances such as animals are unable to fulfill this, right? And this is a way of understanding the difference between animal souls, for instance, in our own souls, or animal substances in our own. Consequently, not being able to reason, they, right, these animals, are unable to discover necessary and universal truths, right? Because they lack reason. And then, of course, he goes on to discuss the importance and role of memory for those of us that do have reason, because without memory, we would be unable, obviously, to know what we are and that we are, right? Those two are the two criteria. I think those are really important, right? He says, in order, however, to prove by natural reason that God will preserve forever not only our substance, but also our personality, that is to say, the recollection and knowledge of what we are, it is necessary to join the metaphysical to moral considerations. So you can see here is that one of the things he's concerned with is the immortality of the soul. How can we have any assurance that when we die, our body dies, that our soul remains? Because our soul seems to be in parallel with the body, but we know that bodies die. And ultimately, he's going to say that he is in favor, metaphysically, that every substance is immaterial. Because every substance is immaterial and indivisible, it can't be destroyed, right? So he believes for metaphysical reasons that we're eternal, but how can we have sort of more certainty than this? He thinks we have to merge metaphysics with morality, right? He says, God can be considered not only as the principle and the cause of all substances and of all existing things, but also as the chief of all persons or intelligent substances, as the absolute monarch of the most perfect city or republic, such as is constituted by all spirits together in the universe, God being the most complete of all spirits, at the same time that he is the greatest of all beings, right? So first and foremost, he begins as normal, beginning with the notion that God is the absolute greatest. God's not only the greatest being metaphysically, he's also the greatest being morally, in terms of articulating how we ought to act and live in the world, right? Such that as God is himself the greatest and the wisest of spirits, it's easy to understand that the spirits within with which he can, so to speak, enter in conversation and even into social relations by communicating to them in particular ways his feelings and his will so that they are able to know and love their benefactor must be much nearer to him than the rest of created things, which may be regarded as the instruments of spirits. What he's going to seem to be arguing here is that God's will, God wants us to to be in coordination with him, right? He says in the next chapter, a single spirit is worth the whole world because it not only expresses the whole world, but it also knows it and governs it itself, as does God. So in a certain way here is that the whole universe's creation is made up of these monadic substances, which are independent of each other. In the sense that God is infinite and lives forever, so too does God's creation as an immanent idea for God, right? Let me go back here. He says, scroll down. He says, in this way, we may say that through every substance that, I'm sorry, we may say that though every substance expresses the whole universe, yet the other substances express the world rather than God, while spirits express God rather than the world, this nature of spirit, so noble that it enables them to approach divinity as much as is possible for created things, has a result that God derives infinitely more glory from them than from other beings, right? And that's giving the notion. God desires infinite glory. There's more glory given by these substances, these spirits, which means that even when the body dies, God's glory continues and therefore does the spirits, right? He says, or rather than our beings furnish to spirits the material for glorifying him, the moral quality of God, which constitutes him Lord and monarch of spirits, influences him, so to speak, personally in any unique way. It's through this that he humanizes himself, that he is willing to suffer human woes. And you can see here is that Leibniz is ultimately moving into a direct discussion of Christianity, and that's what the next chapter is, where he discusses the notion that Jesus Christ has revealed to men the mystery and the admirable law of the kingdom of heaven. So I don't really want to go into this because our goal in this course is not really to articulate an argument for Christianity, but to recognize the metaphysical suppositions here. And you can see is that for at this stage in philosophy, metaphysics is in coordination with the theological views of the philosopher. And that's probably still true today, but we'll see here is that he gives an utterly modern and unique, strange philosophy, but he also is trying to articulate it in a way which is consistent with his own Christian belief system. And this forces him to modify his views on belief in God to some degree. Now, the next section, which is monadology, I'm going to leave up to you to read. But we've discussed all of the integral mechanics of the monadology, which is basically that each substance is a monad, and each of these are simple. And by simple, they have no parts, and so on and so forth. So I'm going to, just for sake of brevity, I'm going to end our discussion here.